For years, Terry has spotted the shape-shifting UFO above his house. He's managed to document the object on his phone.
What I wanted to show you is right here. This thing was following me. This is here in Dallas. Mm-hmm.
Where are you in these pictures?
I'm driving a car. Mm. I'm trying to take pictures of these things. Take your finger and spread that apart.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow, that looks similar to one of our photos.
And did that thing maintain its shape?
No.
This one was kind of morphing as well.
Morphing, yeah. To an orb,
and
then to a sundial.
Ben compares Terry's photo to images of the shape-shifting craft Steve Murillo shared with him.
Wow.
But Terry's experience with the shape-shifting UFO started long before this 2019 snapshot. He first saw it 46 years ago.
It's while I was on active duty, stationed at Whiteman Air Force Base, just southwest of Kansas City.
One to Charlie 4.
Go ahead.
Well, what's your location, sir?
Terry and another medic were responding to a call when they got stopped at a roadblock.
There was a captain there in the road who said, you know, park your ambulance over there, stay off the radio, don't get out of your ambulance. I'm like, okay, yes, sir.
But Terry's colleague was not as obedient.
My friend, who was kind of the impulsive one, was like, I'm gonna go out and see what's going on. Pulling me out of the ambulance.
When Terry arrived at the missile silo, he couldn't comprehend what he was seeing. There was chaos on the ground. But it's what was in the sky that troubled Terry most.
Suspended over this missile silo, about 50 feet in the air, is a black object. And it was enormous. Black, matte, non-reflective.
Uh-huh.
No insignia, no rivets, no windows, no nothing. And it was enormous. I did a drawing of it contemporaneous with the event.
Could you draw it now?
Sure, I could draw it now.
I'm sure it's ingrained in your memory.
It is, and in my nightmares. That will give you an idea.
Wow, it's that, huge.
Compared to you, looks massive.
In this form, the shapeshifter resembles the craft that Terry claims has been stalking his home.
December 5th, 1948.
On a routine flight from Fairchild Air Force Base in Spokane, the pilot had a close call that almost cost him his life. The authorities recorded the pilot's account of events.
It was a normal flight, but then I saw, I don't know, this large ball of fire flashing across the sky.
Fireball, we get that description a lot.
Yep.
At first, I thought it was a meteor, and I radioed it in. But then it did the damnedest thing. It started moving upward. I'm telling you, my blood ran cold. I didn't know what I was looking at. Then my head started ringing. It hurt like hell. I thought I was gonna die. I'd never seen anything move like the fireball in front of me. Then, all of a sudden, It just disappeared.
Radio control operators state that not moments before, a second sighting was reported by a nearby Pioneer commercial airliner.
We were flying to Seattle when I saw a shooting star right in front of us. Bright light washed over the cockpit and it changed from white to green. It started moving right for us. We were on a collision course. Last minute, I tried to change course. It was as if the pilot of the craft had seen us and wanted to avoid us. It pulled up with a tremendous burst of flame out of its rear and zoomed up into the clouds.
When the UFO moved from one place to another, it left a vapor. Remember what Carolyn said? It was a smoke.
Yeah, that's really strange. Considering that instance is on the front page.
Both pilots were later contacted and interviewed about the incident by, look at this, quote, intelligence officers who didn't identify themselves.
Steve Barone has been documenting Black Triangle sightings in this region for over a decade and is one of the foremost experts on the subject. His home's location between the mountains and nearby military facilities affords him a front row seat to the desert's UFO activity.
So, you had captured a series of photos, right, of this black object.
Yes. I'm really excited to get this evidence in front of you.
Well, let's take a look.
Steve has captured video and stills of a dark triangular object hurtling across the sky, just like the craft Sean saw, and similar to the legendary Phoenix Lights.
All right.
Okay.
When did this happen?
This was just probably a month or two ago. This dark black object just tumbling across the sky.
Wow. What do you think this thing is?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. I turned this into MUFON. It was deemed to be an unknown. And they could not identify what these things were.
But that isn't the only evidence of triangle UFOs that Steve has collected. This video appears to show low-flying orbs accompanying a triangle craft. Could they be some sort of surveillance craft deployed by the triangle?
And you had no sound?
No sound. And I'm just wondering if these were those kind of little scout units or crafts that are going and they're stopping right there.
But when Steve tracked the potential surveillance orbs that came from the triangle, something shocking occurred.
But I'm watching it. This thing comes through the picture. This is what's going on in our world, and it's real.
Something's happening for sure. Now, before I leave, do you mind if you kind of show me out here the skyline where everything is laid out? And
I'm glad you asked. Let's take a trip outside. This is where everything happens.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but my layout here, Nellis is right over here. Then that would mean Area 51.
77 miles right that way, Area 51. All of this mountain right here that you see is called La Madre Mountain.
Okay.
And that's where all the magic happens, a lot of it. Over the nearly 8-year period, I've seen them all around the valley. But the night vision is the key that opened up even more footage to all of these areas.
Well, thank you, Steve. Thank you for everything and for spending the time to kind of map that
thank
out
you
for
guys.
Me.
Could the triangle craft that Steve filmed be related to the beings that took Kateria? Multidimensional creatures would have a tremendous advantage over our primitive perceptions of time and physical reality. So just how alarmed should we be?